take a personal benefit from this occasion, a kind of collateral benefit, because this is an opportunity for me to see this hall from in real life, a hall I have been watching only by television in the period that has marked our lives. So, as an outsider, I will present the larger context within which specialists of human security are developing a concept that is complex, as Ms. Mostafavi said, and is ambiguous, as Professor Sinagra said, whose intervention I enjoyed very much, and I remembered a book by his compatriot Luciano Canfora on the exportation of democracy, seeing the Athenian polis, two Napoleonic wars, two Soviet intervention to Hungary, and of course to the events Professor Sinagra was mentioning. So I find this concept as a person interested in epistemology, a particularly challenging one, because it combines both an analytical power and a technical capacity that was brilliantly demonstrated by our colleague Johansen in his intervention right now. It actually corresponds to the definition of modern science, which is both theoretical but has technological capacity to intervene into concrete situations. Now, the interesting thing about conjunctures we are dealing with is that they are results of heterogeneous social processes whose interaction results in conjunctures, in situations that cannot be anticipated from the immanent logic of any one particular process taking separately. So this, of course, complicates the intervention and the analysis, but it's also a challenge. Now, I will present to you seven major disruptive processes that are going on now, right now, or have started in the last third of the 20th century. Six of them have been well developed in a popular book by Daniel Cohen, Three Lessons on Post-Industrial Society. It was a bestseller in France some time ago. And the seventh one, The New Role of the State, is an element I have contributed modestly. The seven disruptive processes that mean a huge historical break are the Third Industrial Revolution that changes labor processes and social processes as a whole. It introduces possibility of increasing productivity of labor, not only with technological innovation, but also with new organizational patterns of enterprises. And it has sadly been mostly used to increase surplus exploitation and to increase productivity in the way of introducing what we considered pre-capitalist modes of exploitation, like slavery, precarious work, etc. Now, new organization of labor process is the consequence, of this industrial revolution, but it has also developed independently. The beginning is considered the so-called Toyotism during the 60s. One of the important processes we are all shocked or fascinated by is financial revolution. It's not only that finance capital is now dominating traditionally productive and commercial capital, it has consequences that go far, far away. It broke down the Fordist the Fordist social compromise of the social state, or socialist state, or social democratic state, and introduced coalition of owners and managers against the workers, against the labor power, while before it was managers and workers against shareholders, against the owners. Another process is privatization of public services. Colleague Johansson was speaking about it. It's a very important process, a process that has not been put under control, and that has very important and sometimes disastrous consequences. Another one is cultural revolution against the institutions of social state and traditional social compromise. It's a cultural revolution that was started in 68. Some of us participated to it. It had results that were not anticipated. It was a revolution against family, factory, and school. And the result is that instead of classical factory, we now have corporations that are lean and mean, and production is outsourced and left to brutal modes of exploitation. Instead of school, we have entire life education, and instead of family, we have churches and family therapies. So the next process is second globalization after colonialism and imperialism of the 19th and the first part of the 20th century. We now have this liberal, neoliberal homogenization of world market and free movement of capital and goods, but not free movement of people. And that's an important factor in increasing the productivity of capital, the migrant labor. And then now we have another process that's going on under our eyes, the new role of the state, the social state. And by social state, I mean social democratic Occidental or Western state, or real socialism, historical socialism in the East. The proclaimed goal that gave legitimation, that legitimized those states, was welfare of the population. Now contemporary states no longer can afford this. They have to take care of capital-friendly environment to attract foreign, global capital that's moving around, and they, of course, now manage the human resources and natural resources in a way that is capital-friendly, but not always population-friendly. So I have described the main features, and we could take as one of the central points financial revolution, which broke down the previous Fordist social contracts between workers and the management, and organized a new antagonism, owners or shareholders against stakeholders. The Dean, Milashinovich, mentioned right to labor, right to work in his address. That's an archaic right that hardly is ever mentioned nowadays, but it's being perverted nowadays with the introduction of new types of labor relations, euphemistically called non-standard employment arrangements, which means you don't have pension security, you don't have holidays, you don't have birth birth leave, and you work like 16 hours a day, like the beginning of the 19th century. So what is happening? Now, one theory that I like is the world system theory, which which considered that capitalism is moving in the waves, in cycles, which were first described by Fernand Braudel, a French historian, and when then taken by the school of world system. Now we are just witnessing the end, the phase B, the decreasing phase of the 20th century cycle, which was going on under United States hegemony. We are not knowing what is going to happen. Maybe a new Eastern Asian cycle will begin, or maybe not. Or maybe we'll have a military empire without market, or we'll have free market without legal control. You bet which is worse. So now I will go to the... Now, look, this is United Nations Human Development Report 2013, which describes the same situation in different terms, which means the rise of the South. BRIC countries, Brazil, China, and India, are overtaking the central countries like Canada, France, United Kingdom, and United States in output on the world scale. So that's definitely something new is happening. And I should mention this. Another ambassador of Japan mentioned inequalities. Now that's one of the very dramatic processes that's going on. I have some good computations. Well, these are wages in France, Europe, and G7. The part of wages in GDP is falling down. This is an incredibly good graph. It was calculated by Michel Husson, a French non-orthodox economist. This is part of salaries in the United States from 60 to 2005. And which is the interesting thing is the, this is European Union average. This is United States, much higher than European Union if you take salaries in the whole, globally. Now, if you take the 1% of the highest salary, salaries off, then United States approach European Union. And if you take 10% of the highest salaries off, then the average in the United States is lower than in European Union, which means that United States are becoming a very unegalitarian society. This is a nice graph that was published by Thomas Piketty, now becoming, it's a bestseller, Capital in the 21st Century. It has become bestseller after having been translated into English before. It was available in French for 1 year without being a world bestseller. Now this is a long term, 200 years calculation of inequalities. And the two interesting points are that the inequalities in Europe and the United States are the peak right before World War I. That was the worst situation. Then after the World War I, and especially after World War II, the inequalities decrease. And then in the 60s, it's only in the 60s that the United States, the inequality in the United States overtakes Europe. So, you know, the United States were an egalitarian society until the 60s, and Europe, it's us who were in non-egalitarian. So, and this is an Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development graph, which is incredible, the inequalities among the members. And it's very telling to see what are the most inegalitarian countries. It's Chile, Mexico, and Turkey. And which one is the less inegalitarian? It's Slovenia. So that's one of the few elements one can be proud of, Slovenia. And of course, it's a heritage of socialism. look, let me just make the point, the morals of this story. It is that new and deepening social inequalities, marginalization of large social groups, transfer of risks towards households and individuals, and emergence of grassroots strategies to counter the new challenges. Now, what is the grassroots strategies? They are characteristically developed on the level of households and larger social groups, like ethnic and religious communities. This leads to fragmentation of society and produces new social tensions and conflicts. What I want you to present is a sociological paradox, that the strategies households and smaller communities like religious or ethnic ones are taking actually increases the process they should be fighting. Because what do they do? They the households have to complete more tasks with no public health, no public pension funds, etc. More tasks with less money and less secure, more precarious, more fragile sources of income. You know, the father has just lost his job. The mother is a precarious kitchen worker in some service. The daughter goes to flea market to sell little things once a week, and the son brings occasionally large sums of money. Nobody wants to ask him where he got them. So there's a modern family. And what do? They have to bring together all those resources to survive. And how do they do it? They increase control and discipline and family control. What does it mean nowadays? It means patriarchal family, control over female members, of course, and control over the children and discipline. So what do we get? We get patriarchal family ideologies. We get mos maiorum. You know, the traditional values, and they seek support in social environment. Where they get it? In ethnic and religious communities. And we get an identitary reaction, grassroots identitary reaction to those processes. And of course, identitary constructions are explosive and dangerous. Why? Because they condense various social processes and conflicts, none of which is can be resolved on the basis of ethnicity. So look, this is a pessimistic note. I don't want to end on a pessimistic note, and that's why I got a quotation from Fernand Braudel, Le Modèle Italien, where he says, when Italy lost when Italy could no more compete for Mediterranean domination because the center of activities shifted to Atlantic, the great cultural flourishment of Italy came. So Renaissance and Baroque are in many ways the consequence of Italian cities having lost their struggle for world domination. And that's the situation of Europe today. Thank you.